Hi guys, I'm Daddy Freeze, convener of the Free the Sheeple movement and leader of the Free Nation in Christ. I greet you and I bring glad tidings. I'm going to very, very quickly touch on a very dicey topic that is currently affecting the faith. So I'm going to start first of all with a quick prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to gather. I thank you for blessing us. I thank you for your love, your kindness, and your mercy that has been upon us. And I ask for direction, O Lord, in Yahushua's name I pray. Amen. You see, right now, many of you have come to the understanding that a lot of your old daddy geos are, I can't say the word, are not what they claim to be. Many of you can see that they don't have the intellectual capacity they claim. They don't have the foresight they claim to have. They don't have the understanding of the gospel they claim to have. They don't have the spirituality and the prophecy ability that they need to have. Many of you can see this, and you can see it with all clarity. So a lot of the younger generation is steering away from the older churches. Many of you are going to, how are you, Mrs. Linda? Many of you are going to these older churches because your parents went there. Some of you are too afraid to tell your parents the truth. Some of you do things out of respect for your parents. I'm going there because of my dad. My dad always wanted me to attend this particular church. My dad was a knight in this particular church. So many of you are going there for sentimental reasons, but deep down many of you know that there is no God in their gospel. And with the recent happenings in the church world, a geo's wife was barred from attending a former bank MD's funeral. Ebiri, how are you? Ebiri, the live goer. So a lot of you have been awakened. You hear the gospel from these old geos. You hear the gospel from these prayer warriors, and you even though you go there, something inside you is telling you, be careful, be careful, be careful. It's like your boyfriend cheated on you before. You caught him the first time, you caught him the second time, you wanted to break up the relationship, he came crying and said, no, don't worry, I'm never gonna cheat on you, I'm always gonna be there with you, I'm gonna make sure, blah 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 blah. Then one day, 3 weeks later, he says, Arsenal is playing football, I want to go to the bar to go and watch. You go to use side eye, they look him. Just like when you go to church and your geo releases a prophecy, you use side eye to look at him. Because you know. But you see, the problem is not those old daddy geos. Whether you like it or not, even if you physically attend their church every day, your body has left the church. Look at what happened to Marigold. A pastor told her to bring her 15 million naira and told her he would invest it for her. At the end of the day, the pastor ate the whole money. So you reduce that music. So you know that whether you like it or not, that gospel is an old breed. But you see, the really dangerous ones are the new ones who understand how to use social media. Those ones who understand how to put effect inside their gospel. I'm not saying they don't have truth in them. They do have some truth, but they are dangerous. Because you are going to their pages, you are going to their churches, you are going with your guards down, you are going to lose guard. You are going to lose guard and they're going to mess with you. You see, the trick is connect with the people. It's the greatest marketing and sales strategy. Connect with the people. Give them what they want to hear. Then you give them what you want them to hear. Wyclef Jean was a classic example of using this formula. Wyclef Jean came as a rapper. He knew that if he could sing, nobody would buy that music. But he first of all came as a rapper. Gave them what they wanted to hear. When he had their attention, he gave them that his croaky voice. Someone call me 911. When you have their attention, you see, a lot of people do not know what the gospel is about. They don't understand the good news. What they understand is the feel good news. So they're going to come and connect with you on a feel good message. They're going to tell you about your family. They're going to tell you, if your children want to listen to this type of message, they're going to connect with you on that cellular. And let me tell you, the Bible warned you about these people. Let me give you a very profound Bible message. It says 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 3, for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. Instead, they will follow their own desires and look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. So these young guys, bereft of any scriptural knowledge, they don't even know history. Forget scripture. Again, one of them, when me and Shem Kuti challenged the other day, they don't know diddly. But they're going to come marketing you with life stories. And it's okay, they have a lot of truth in them, don't get me wrong. When it comes to life advice, don't choose a man that will do this to you, they are 100%. The problem is when they now give you the gospel. It's like a woman who told you, you are calling her, where are you going to? I'm going to my mother's house. You call her mother, she's there. Honey, I'm going to the gym. You call the gym. Your wife just entered the gym now, like 2 minutes ago. When she built your trust, the day she's going to tell you she's going to the gym, she will actually go to the gym and someone will pick her up from that gym, but she has already bought your trust. So they're going to come, and the problem is you are never, the scriptures speak of something here that are very, very profound. It says, Hygnosis didakalios, sound teaching. You are no longer looking for sound teaching. You want to hear certain things. And when you hear those things, you connect with the person. Let me tell you, a person is telling you exactly what you need to hear about your kids. If somebody came to you, I remember how hard it was when I was growing up. I also connect to some of their messages. But you see, the difference between me and you is I've gone through the scriptures. proper tutelage. Someone like Simply Vic, I can send him the message and say, ah, this is a true message. This guy is correct here. I will never send them to you. Because once you begin to take one, two, three, the fourth one is going to lie and you will believe it. The fourth one is going to lie. And he's going to lie with the same authority that he used to tell you the truth. That's where the danger is. The danger is not the lie. The danger is the authority behind the lie. And he's going to connect with you. And then you're going to... You see, there's this new rise in social media pastors. They came. They understood what the church wants to hear. They knew. One of them even speaks the truth 80% of the time. Doesn't know anything about the gospel, doesn't know anything about spirituality, but they speak the truth 80% of the time. That's the danger. Because that 20% where they lie is leaning on the authority given by the 80%. And you see, in science, you can do 20 correct things. When you do one fake thing, you will not, that 20 is not going to give you the strength to hold a lie. 20 truths in science is not going to validate a lie. But 3 truths in the faith is going to validate 20 lies. So somebody sent me one of their messages today. I watched the video. I'm like, there's a lot of truth in what this guy is saying. But you see, he is telling you life truths, not the gospel truth. The gospel is different from real life. And many people cannot separate the gospel from real life. I sat down with somebody today and said, if Christianity, the worship of God through Christ, was meant to make you rich, why were the apostles poor? If it was meant to protect you from harm, why were all the apostles quiet? If it was meant to make you healthy, why was Timothy often sick? I need answers. I bring the Bible and put it in front of you. And I ask you those pertinent questions. Forget those things you want to see. Forget those things your itchy ears want to hear. The question is, somebody remind me what I said. Someone said Timothy was often sick. You did not know. Oh, let me read the Bible for you. Who can help me? Ada, are you here? If Ada is here, maybe she can read Bible for me. I don't like reading the Bible for myself because people don't believe me. Sorry, I'm replying a text message. Sorry, forgive me, guys. I try to make my messages not too formal so that somebody can call me. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 23. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 23. The scripture says, don't drink only water. You ought to drink a little wine for the sake of your stomach because you are sick so often. New International Version, that was a New Living Translation. New International Version says your frequent illnesses. King James said, for thy stomach's sake and thine often infirmities. New King James says your frequent infirmities. If you read this in the original language it was written, which is Koine Greek, the Greek rendition says, sickness, so athenias, the frequency of your ailments. So Timothy was often sick. The gospel is not a guarantee of good health. Your pastor may be lucky. Your pastor may have never had malaria before in his life. Maybe your pastor has a secret doctor that is treating him on the side. Maybe your pastor is using, let me give you an example, Areafe Babalola. Areafe Babalola is 96 years old. Let me show you a video of me and him. 96 years old. His brain is still sound. He doesn't have high blood pressure. He doesn't have diabetes. Anytime I'm in Adoekiti, I have lunch with him almost every day. I go and visit him in his office and gist with him. He works every day. No. Afebala doesn't work every day. Afebala gets to the office at 8 a.m. Goes home to sleep at 3 p.m. Comes back to work at 7 p.m. and closes at 12 midnight. Every day, including Sunday. Okay, Sunday he doesn't come out. He goes to church. When it's not one particular faith. He is 96 years old. He is not particularly religious. He doesn't cast and bind or speak in tongues. He is healthier than probably everybody in your entire family. At 96. Meanwhile, my father is 80. He's not yet 80. My father is going to be 79 this year. My father has had open heart surgery already. So if my father goes to, imagine Afe Babalola was now a pastor and he's telling you the God that did it for me. If my father decides to throw away his medicine, would have buried him since. Interdenominational, God bless you. That there was a gist I heard about Are. I probably should have asked him about it. They said he got to work one day, was coming from his office around 8:30 and saw somebody dozing. He just tapped the guy, said, go home. Now, so he takes sack the guy. He said, at 8 a.m. I've been here since 5. I've already put in 3 hours of work. You are coming in at 8 and you are dozing. You are not ready to work. So when somebody like that comes to tell you, meanwhile, Are's mother probably lived to be 100. So if that same person came to use themselves as a point of contact, you, where your papa get diabetes, your mama family get dementia, your mama family get hypertension, only you get 3 things where you inherit from the previous generation. You know one can't use medicine. You go buy. I'll tell you two. I personally know 2 people. One, a friend of mine's brother, who became a pastor in one of these top 2 GOs church. You know, just one of them. Just pick them. This guy had ulcer and refused to take medicine. It's bad enough you are not treating the ulcer with medicine. You are treating the ulcer with faith. The next thing is you are now fasting. Ulcer where you know treat. Ulcer where you they neglect. You they use fasting and you can't they fast. So let us say you even chop food. At least the food go they help your stomach, make it not dissolve your stomach lining. You can't they pray, they cast. I just saw RIP on my friend's WhatsApp. I was still in Cool FM then. I remember driving home. I was driving my Range Rover then. So this was, I sold my Range Rover in 2019. So this was anywhere. I was already living in Lekki. So it was, I moved to Lekki in 2017. And I was driving my Range. So it was between 2015, 2017 and 2019. I just saw, I call my guy, I say, what thing do your brother? He say, bye you. Then I saw him brother become pastor, he refused to take medicine. Ordinary ulcer, nine fire. I'll tell you a second story. My sister's neighbor in Chevron, in an estate not far from Northern Foreshore. Use your eye, they judge all the estates we did there. One day, I saw a little girl that ran to my sister. You know, estate life, everybody go know everybody else. My, how are you, auntie? You know, hey, how are you? Where's your mommy? She just went out with my daddy. I just saw that my sister's face was straight. Okay, greet her for me. You know, she tried my sister. So when she go, I call ask my sister, say, ah, Yoruba, ni mi momoju momara. Ask my sister, say, what's up? It seems like you were a bit disconnected. That this girl's papa just died like 6 months ago. That daddy, where should they follow come out? Now the new husband, where mama just married. I can't see the mama. Fine girl, call V. You know those girls where their body they soft. I don't look on. See the mama go pick the pikin. My sister say, now ulcer now by the husband. He no reach 6 months, the mama, the wife don't remarry. What happened? The husband had ulcer and was fasting. Was fasting this 40 days fast that they do at the beginning of the year. Ulcer hook the guy. They rush the guy, go hospital. They say, make the guy drink medicine. The guy say, no, I'm breaking fast. I can tell you for free that that guy is on his way to hellfire. Because you will be held responsible for your stupidity. As far as this thing, I swear to God, I cannot just tell you which of my sisters. So I think the woman that had a new man climbing her 6 months later. The daughter was calling a new guy daddy 6 months later because of his stupidity. When you take stupidity and you turn it into a form of gospel, you turn it into a faith system. That guy just bide himself. That is why religion is so dangerous. I remember in Romania, around autumn, they have these mushrooms. In Romanian, mushroom is called ciuperca. And there's this particular species of ciuperca called ghebe. Very delicious. Of all the mushrooms where I don't chop for my life, it get the way that they cook them. If you chop this thing, you will bite your finger. You go bite the table, you go, if the plate na glass, you go chop the glass. If the plate na plastic, you go chop the plastic. So once they are in season like this, everybody go wearing boots. We will come begin the enter inside forest, they go pick the gebe. But there's a problem. The gerbe looks very identical to a very poisonous mushroom. If you don't know the difference, you are going to be in a lot of trouble. If you don't know the difference. So when we go out with our uncles, once we see a cluster of mushrooms, we call our uncle come and look at it. Say, yeah, you can pack that one. He knows how to look. For it. So the elders there, anytime we see, we just call, unkyu, and Vasu Chuparaka. He will now come, oh, yes, you can take that one. No, leave that one. It's just like Ugu. Is he Ugu? Babe, what leaf or stone talking about that day that used to cook that? They said the one that the sun does not reach is more dangerous, is poisonous. Was it Ugu? Was it the root of Ugu? Stone, and that day we're at Utazi. The root of Ugu. That's what he was talking about. My love, start getting ready. K is on our way. Now, Ugu, ordinary Ugu. One of my friends was telling taste buds and I that the root of it is poisonous. That even some of the leaves that are close to the ground, if they use it and cook soup for you, you will log out. How do you tell the difference? Expertise. How do you tell the difference between the feel-good gospel, the feel-good news, and the good news of the gospel? How do you tell the difference? It is impossible for you to tell the difference when you haven't gone through training. When you have people like Simply Vic. Every day, Simply Vic sends me, send me message or send me read 5 different messages arguing about one doctrinal belief or the other. You see my message is Simply Vic. Now doctrine. He understands what Christianity is. He understands what the message is. Let me tell you something here. The gospel of Christianity is one of the most delicate gospels. Because you need to examine the word against the reality. If Christ said something, a word, you now need to reference the lives of the early church. What kind of life did they live? What kind of life did Paul and Peter live? Show me a scripture where Peter or Paul rode a donkey or a horse. Everywhere they went to, they walked. Stop glorifying the gospel of prosperity. There is nowhere in scripture where you can tie prosperity to Christianity. There is nowhere where God promised Christians that they were going to be rich. There are many things that we have mistaken in the gospel. And one of them is this particular scripture. Philippians chapter 4:19. I call it Philippians 4:19 because they use it for 4:19. But it's actually Philippians chapter 4:19. It says, And the same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ. All your needs. You don't need a pure 18 karat gold diamond studded chopard. It is not a need. You don't need a diamond bracelet. You don't need Gucci shoes. You need shoes. You look at Peter Obi, as rich as he is, he wears $50 shoes. You get good shoes for $50. Somebody says God promised Abraham. Now let's work with this stupidity that this guy just brought up here. Let me work with this foolishness. God promised Abraham, Solomon, Job, the list is endless, and they were wealthy. First thing, let me break your heart. None of them was a Christian. Abraham was not a Christian. Solomon was not a Christian. Job was not a Christian. You know who your Christians were? Peter, Paul, Silas, Barnabas, John Mark. Those were Christians. James, John. Stop using Solomon and David and Abraham. They are not Christians. They were not Christians. Oh, you thought Solomon was a Christian? Solomon is Sulaiman in Islam. He's a Muslim prophet. David is Dauda in Islam. He is a Muslim prophet. This is the shallowness that I'm telling you about. That's why I'm warning you about these young preachers. There is no promise of wealth for Christians. It doesn't exist. If it did, Peter and Paul will not be poor. Abraham is not a Christian. Abraham is the father of Islam, the father of Judaism, and the father of Christianity. How can you pick one out of all of them and say that's his religion? Abraham was a Jew, the father of the Jews. And the Jews, till today, you go to Israel, they don't practice Christianity. They are more Muslims than Christians in Israel. Percentage of Islam in Christianity is about 17%. Percentage of Christianity in Israel is about 2%. 70 something percent practice Judaism. So how can you dare say Abraham was a Jew? I'm sorry, well, Abraham was a Christian. How? Why do you like deceiving yourself? Abraham is Ibrahim in Islam. When you hear somebody answering Ibrahim, his name is Abraham. Because the Muslims are also descendants of Abraham. So how can you say Abraham? Okay, God promised Abraham you'll be wealthy. So why wasn't Paul wealthy? So when I say there is no promise for Christians to be wealthy, stop going to dig out Old Testament people. Many of those gospels have expired. Abraham was not a Christian. Job was not a Christian. The books that were chosen for the Bible were not chosen by Christians. They were chosen by people who wanted to use religion to play politics. And let me tell you something. Solomon, David, brother, Joseph, the first Christian. Christianity started after the cross. Anything before that was Jewish religion. Christ himself was not a Christian. Oh, let me break your heart. Oh, you think Christ was a Christian? They think Christ was a Christian. That's why I said the Christians were Peter, Paul, James, John, Barnabas, John Mark, Silas. Those were the first Christians. Christ himself was not a Christian. You know, you did not know. He was born into Judaism. And he came to right the errors in Judaism. And the followership of Christianity, of Christ, became what you know today as Christianity. But you see, the proof you are looking for to back up those your false doctrines, you will never find them in the teachings of Christianity. So you have to go and dig them out from the teachings of Judaism. Anything you see in the Bible before the teachings of Christ started belongs to a religion called Judaism, a religion that does not believe in Christ. That is why some people say the Bible is contradictory. Yes, there are lots of things in the Bible that do not sound like they came from the same place. However, it would be a lot less contradictory if you know what is meant for you. The whole Old Testament is meant to explain how the New Testament is coming. It is not meant for you to use doctrinally. I'll read a scripture to you. Go with me to Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. I'm ending soon. Oops. Kayla is downstairs. I told you to get ready. Sorry, guys, 1 second. So I'll just end with this Genesis chapter 12, and then let's read from verse 7. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, I'll give you this land to your descendants. And Abraham built an altar there and dedicated it to the Lord who had appeared to him. I want to jump to Genesis 12 verse 1. The Lord said to Abraham, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I'll show you. And I'll make you into a great nation. I will bless you, and I'll make you famous, and you'll be a blessing to others. I'll bless those who bless you, and curse those who curse you. And those who treat you with contempt, all their families on earth will be best through you. And the Lord said, I will give you this land. Are you living in the land today? Hmm. Are you living in that land today? The land that God promised Abraham. Why are you not living there? Are we blessed those who bless you? Are we cursed those who curse you? The people that curse you, how many of them have been cursed? I ask you. The people that look at you in contempt, how many of them have been looked upon in contempt? Some of you do not understand that this book should not be taken literally. It is an allegorical book, a metaphorical book. It's dangerous for you to take it literally. It is extremely dangerous for you to take it literally. Anyway, guys, I'm going to continue with the topic. Join us in church tomorrow, 12:30 p.m. We're going to continue. We're going to have a deep session tomorrow. I just wanted to touch up on this a little bit. I didn't even know. I thought I would do it in 20 minutes. I've double shot my time. I'm still coming back a little later to talk about Jack Ma and all those fun things that we like to talk about on this live. Take care, guys, and God bless you all.